positive as it exists, normative what it ought to be. Right? The distinction is very, very important. Second issue is that, you know, yesterday I was mentioning about the causation, Elaine's formulation. The private sector has not delivered quality. There are very few good private sector, there are quite a good number of publicly funded institutions. But why? Because the very rationale advocated by the neoliberals have been falsified. Because the assumptions are not really tenable in the context of education. It has happened because all the efficiency, maximization, profit making, all are questionable. So this point has come out that, you know, why private sector has failed to deliver. The third dimension is, it's very, very important to understand the motive behind the private participation. And the motive, if education is not for business, then why the private sector would be interested in investing education? That particular question would throw light on some of the tussles, some of the confusions, some of the this asymmetry in the partnership we can actually understand. The fourth question is about the process. And I was just, when I was listening, I just remembered one typical case which was shared by one UGC representative at our center. You know, the B.Ed colleges have mushroomed in India. The private B.Ed colleges in the state of Tamil Nadu, the southern part of the country, were full. But the government-funded B.Ed colleges, fees are very low. They had only 2 to 3 students, at the most 3 to 4. The class capacity is 55. Apparently, it is a puzzle. The private B.Ed colleges are classes are full, but government-funded colleges, classes would be having 3 to 4 colleges. But, you know, I could, it's a puzzle you think about. Subversion of the process, and here, the role of the students are very, very important. The students are being misled by the private, the students are also party to the low quality education. The next dimension is about, this the larger role. When you're thinking about how can education contribute to the common good, that is the very, the idea of this particular collaboration. We have to really talk about the curriculum, and how privatization of education can affect the process, and therefore the students and the teachers become more and more individualistic in their approaches. Mm-hmm. Because after all, when you're talking about the common good, we have to undergo the transformation, and the transformation should contribute to the larger community. And that is not going to happen when you are bringing in the privatization of education because of the cost recovery, the fees, and many other things. I need not elaborate on this. Anupam has really raised a very important set of questions, particularly the partnership, the asymmetry, the accountability. I'm not going to talk about it. And so, I also thought about it, that there is something on paper, there is something on practice, and the distinction between the two is very, very important. When you are thinking about the common good, the diversity question is very, very important, because in a country like India, which is hugely diverse, marketization and the increasing role of the privatization can actually undermine the diversity dimension, because it's more and more segregation. The other issue, which has not really come out, I mean, that was not possibly the major agenda of this presentation. When you are thinking about how education can contribute to the larger public good character of education and the common good, I think there is a decline of social sciences, when you are talking about higher education. And that would undermine criticality, that would suffocate criticality. And these are extremely important. The other dimension, that how the public good character of higher education and knowledge generation would not really necessarily cater to the larger interest of the society, is the private funding of research. When you bring the private funding to the research domain, then the articulation of their mission through market, through profit, may not really do justice to the need of the society. And the last point I would like to mention about some of the recent initiative mooted in the budget. I don't have time, possibly I've just taken 5 minutes. The advocacy for the private is eminently clear. The world-class universities, 10 private and 10 public. Why 10 private, right? From a smaller set, right? So the approach or the attitude of the government is eminently clear when it comes to the Institute of Eminence.
that one of the 10 private universities are going to be, and regulation, debate, and autonomy are not going into this. And the last issue, because I have already taken 6 minutes, 1 minute extra.
You are point
not,
number nine, so.
No, sorry.
That's out of the five.
I will not speak. The last issue is about. The last issue about, there is a serious need for the database research. How privatization has led to, in case it has led to, I believe it has led to, accentuation of various disparities and the intersection of the disparity. That is very, very important. And here, I believe the school education and higher education have to be understood together. Because when you are looking at access to higher education, you have to understand the educational attainment at the 10 plus 2 level. If you don't juxtapose one with the other, you will not get the two pictures. So it is, one is the inequalities getting accentuated. The second related dimension, the social mobility question, you have to bring in higher education and how privatization can actually affect social mobility. Because in the majority, 75 to 80% in the professional education is actually private, right? So the coaching, education loan, distortion in the choice making from the students of underprivileged section, because they are risk averse, right? All these issues are very, very important, because education investment is a life-making decision. The choices are distorted, social mobility would suffer. Some of these interesting questions, I believe, with the help of data and research can throw light on. 1 minute extra.
Thank you. Public and what is the private in this country? And I actually beg to disagree. Because if you go back, and I've done quite a lot of work on the Nehruvian era, actually the public was very clear. Mm-hmm. And India comes out of a Nehruvian legacy, which had at the base of socialism and public welfare. And the idea of the public was extremely clear, and the private was extremely clear. There was a clear distinction between both of them, and I think we should not forget this. And there is an issue in the fact that the public was not successful in actually providing for everyone, and because some hard choices were made. Higher education was privileged over education for all because India needed doctors and engineers. And we should not forget that this is one of the reasons why basic education was not available to all. So hard choices were made in the early years of independence. And the second point, which takes us to 1991, which is also the year that I've done a lot of work on, with the opening up and globalization, bringing in neoliberalism. Again, our colleagues in housing said neoliberalism is not relevant to this country. I think neoliberalism is extremely relevant to this country, at least when you come from an education and also I think from a health background. Neoliberalism is extremely important. And Geeta and I have worked on exactly that in the book that Saumen contributed to as well, with regard to how globalization brought in the idea of neoliberalism, which brought in changes in education. Now, in the first literature review, you said something about how the World Bank came in and how in post-1991 you had all these development partners and education schemes which started. I think it sounded very like it was all positive, and I think perhaps a critical eye needs to be shed on that. That's just in brackets to that. I think it definitely changed the approach to education. And there's no mystery about when you have the private sector enter a public sector that the middle classes generally are the ones who benefit. I think we've seen this across the sectors and we've seen this across countries. I've written a few years ago a chapter on how the middle classes fled the public education system. And that's when the quality starts to go down. When the middle classes leave the public education system, that's when the problems end. They were happy because they suddenly had choice to go elsewhere, to buy themselves out of what was a system which was quite restrictive because socialism in India hadn't given them that choice. And so we should not forget that it's that point of the Nehruvian legacy which gets trashed in 1991, broadly speaking, and then the middle classes who flee the public sector. And so this is when we then get to the 4 points that I want to make. I think the rise of the private has a lot of public support. And it has a lot of public support because the aspiring middle class, the people who are coming upwards, and everyone is aspiring to move one rung upwards, ultimately speaking, see that if the middle classes are going to private, we should as well. And the whole issue of English medium schools. And so that's one thing I would like to see addressed perhaps in this Q&A, but perhaps also in the paper, in terms of this public support for the role of the private in whatever shape or form it may come. It's sufficient to have English medium on your board outside, and people will flock. And so this is something that I have seen also in the villages that I work in Pune, outside of Pune and out in Banswara and Rajasthan, where anyone who can, they'll skip a meal, but they will send their children to quote-unquote Loki, as long as it's English medium. So the language and the issue is very, very important here. The second thing is, I think we need to have a particular study. This might be beyond this literature review, but I think India, because of the SC, ST, OBC, so scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, other backward classes, these different groups, how the private sector has affected these different categories, because it's affected it differently. Again, in my villages in Banswara, when I go, Banswara is a tribal region, but the little bits of OBCs that we have all bought out, and they go to the nearest town, and they go to the low-fee, low-cost private school. In Pune, which is a very mixed area, where you have all castes and all classes living in different hamlets across villages, it's the government caters only to SCS. And so it has, clearly the private sector has affected these demographics differently, so that's where India is quite different from the rest of the world, and I think we need to have a look at that. And I think also within that point, so that's the third point that I'm making, I think we need to look at the difference between for-profit and not-for-profit. I tend to, in my work on Pakistan, work differentiate between schools that are philanthropic and schools that are for-profit in terms of the low-fee private sector. Because, and I'm wondering if here there are differences as well, because in Pakistan there are clear differences. The not-for-profit sector in low-fee private or low-cost private in Pakistan has actually made quite a difference with regard to gender, for example. I don't know what the differences are here, and perhaps that's something we need to look at. Also the question about, I've read about case studies where land was given, where clearly this becomes a VBP, the government gives land, the private sector comes in, builds a school, is supposed to give a certain number of access, but then actually opens a school in the afternoon with para teachers, and therefore they are meeting the letter of the law, but not the spirit of the law. So again, these are the kind of things which probably need addressing. The other thing I want to say about low-cost, low-fee private, which needs to be at least addressed in some ways, that this can only survive on the back of either untrained or little-trained female teachers.
Yes.
And this low-cost labor in Pakistan actually paid on the manual labor scale. I don't know what scale is used here, if any at all, because they are untrained. So again, the use of the question of the para teacher, the use of anyone who's had, you know, level to grade 10, grade 12 education is able to teach in one of the low-fee schools. I think that links directly into the issue of quality and is something we need to address. The last point I want to make is, I think you've mentioned it, the motives. We need to understand the motives. Now, the motives for philanthropic organizations are clearly quite different from the motives of corporates. And perhaps we need to categorize, that's why it's quite important to differentiate between philanthropic organizations, not-for-profit organizations, who might be meeting their CSR component bits, and those who are for-profit. Again, just going across the border, the not-for-profit, the philanthropic providers in Pakistan very often have an ethos, either a religious ethos or a secular ethos in certain cases, which they're trying to push through that, so it would be quite interesting to see what happens. Yeah. That's it. Thank you very much.
Question, and it's perhaps for all of you, it's like you said, you know, we need to differentiate between for-profit and philanthropic and these policy or these kind of motives, but how different are they really, I think is my question. You know,
I think they could be quite different. I don't think we have the answer. I think that some of our study on that would be quite interesting.
Yeah, because I think when they're mixed up with CSR things, there's clearly...
Okay, so mixed up with CSR, perhaps, but
I mean, maybe that we need to even differentiate it within philanthropic.
Well, yeah, yes. CSR.
I mean, the
Gates
Foundation
is
non-profit, isn't it? But that's... Okay. Empirical studies about the kind of more... What sort of empirical studies are there about the kind of impact on caste and the different groups? And that's what it's really... Thank you.
So do you just want to...
little bit of clarification. Maybe I'm coming. I think this ties in with the last issue that just been raised. Could you say perhaps something about the role of foreigners compared to domestic actors around their interest in it? Because you kind of nicely tie the issues together around the push for education for all. At the same time, we have GATS, so we have internationalization of education, and you point to the role of the World Economic Forum. So, is there a strong presence of foreign private actors in education, or is it mainly domestic private actors that have an interest in the, I'm talking for the for-profit sector. So that's one. And then perhaps picking up on something that Saumen mentioned, and actually I think this is perhaps a gap in the reviews, is that we have nothing on the role of students, learners, social movements, contestations by students or teacher unions or whatever. So I'm just wondering, we were told there was demonstrations going on at TCS yesterday, I mean, we could hear them as we were speaking.
See the banners out.
So I'm just wondering whether you can give us perhaps a little bit of insight on what has been the response. I mean, there must be responses within through social movements, whether there are responses that are organized on the level of the teachers, responses that are organized at the level of the students, higher education or schools. Just to have a little bit of an idea of whether there has been that contestation of this, which I presume.
Thank you. So my question is, I've not studied PPPs in education per se, but if we really demarcate it as 92, the Nehruvian socialist era and the 92 post-liberal era, liberalization era, I always see education where there has always been some form of private intervention, even if it was the Nehruvian socialist era, say in the form of philanthropy or say charitable trusts were formed where they built schools and then. And so I don't know then how to understand what is a PPP. So now if it's a CSR initiative, suddenly we call it a PPP, or you mentioned about Adarsh, where they're giving autonomy to the private. So is it after 92, the initiative, it seems like that the post-92 initiatives, this, because there are these models given by the government, we are framing it in the, contextualizing it as PPPs, but education has been something where there has always been a private intervention, some form or the other. So then how do we understand what is PPP? Like how do we define PPP? Define is a very crude, not define, but how do we formulate the idea of PPP in education?
Yeah, I think what Mari said is very important. And to come to your question, I think collaborations existed, but partnerships are a completely different understanding. So that, I think, is one. You're absolutely right, and I don't think 1991 is a very useful marker for our analysis, but the processes had started much before that. I would say Rajiv Gandhi's prime ministership was really the, the ideas of neoliberalism were in circulation.
But the finance came in post-91.
Right. So that came in and gave it legitimacy in a way. And one of the things I thought in your presentation, which Saumen alluded to, is important, because you have to look at what happened to primary, secondary education and higher education together. Because I think that also addresses a very important question that Mari raised about what really happened to the character of the Indian polity and its citizenry, in a sense, of what we look at in the middle class, especially the aspirational middle class, and its demonstration effect, I think is very important. And lastly, like in health, I think we need to look at the circulation of not just corporations, but we have to look at private equity and venture funding coming into education. And I didn't hear that at all in the review, which you probably have, but I think it's very important to look at, because we are seeing a parallel in health as well. So maybe some of these things would be very useful to look at the complexity of partnerships in today's world.
I think we close those questions at the moment with this. I think, Anupam, why don't you take what's relevant to you and then we can do the...
So the involvement of foreign partners and how we look at it. So one part is the foreign aid, which came for EFA, for the DPEP program, and what it led to. In at the onset of the DPEP, it led to district level planning in the, you know, across the country. However, there are issues. Padma Sarampani has written in on it also. How that there are issues of then formation of this society, which again is kind of distancing itself from the state. Well, the state as the main regulator. So that is loose, and how money went. The good part of it was that money went to the lowest level in the organization of the state, to the districts, where there was planning and distribution and control over it. So there could be issues about. But then we need to differentiate between the role of development organizations versus banks, you know, investment organizations with interest of investment. And how their language, their emphasis, the way they interpret efficiency, you know, in terms of development organizations had this thing of capacity building, working with the grassroots, for the democratic, you know, processes, bringing in the marginalized. World Bank much later, you know, when they had this, you know, poverty alleviation programs and all those country papers, people started writing, and they had instituted studies on looking at poverty, inviting anthropologists. Till then, I mean, their language has been of, you know, efficiency, low cost, and then same. Thinking that the same quality of services can be provided, you know, with lower money. So, and this whole thing of their scarcity of money, their scarcity of funds. So that discourse being pushed by on the other hand, if we go to the grassroots level and work with people, it seems that development organizations gave this idea that they need to fund public. So you just need to work, and there's so much fun. And both of these had a positive as well as negative impact on how people started looking at money, and then the issue. For example, corruption in education is still an area which is largely neglected in terms of research on corruption in education, with all these funds coming in. In terms of the social movements, as I said, many organizations really they were benefited by the help from the International Development Organization funding the grassroots organization. But there is literature available where which political ideology is, you know, supported through these development partners, and how that changed the politics. In Rajasthan, there's a whole lot of work in Mahila Samakhya, how it just turned the politics in the state. And so, however, I mean, Rajasthan has this history of Congress and BJP, you know, one after another. But the nature of state in terms of their support for, private, and this increasing discourse in support of private has been increasing. And there is work. For example, when the international participants or the providers, businesses, they come and work, their discourse on education and the participation has remained same, but the strategies have changed. But in terms, for example, when there was Congress government in Rajasthan in 2002, and Microsoft and big organizations had already suffered setback in late 90s, you know, losing money in the South Asia because they thought, because of these, you know, the software being the pirated software and all that. So the IT policy, initial IT policy was started, instituted, and they wanted this was seen as kind of moral thing to have quality proprietary software and need to educate, and therefore giving computers to the school in 2002, while in 2005-06, when the PTP government was there, the same organization was working in collaboration, becoming partner of the Rajasthan Education Initiative, giving free training school to the teachers. But again, the question remains, the strategies might change. They are happy to work with either government, but yeah, okay. And then this thing of, I agree that we need to look across the sectors, and that is only way from primary to higher education. In terms of the cost, access to the various providers, and there are studies in higher education, but we also need to look at the besides the social dimension, the economic, the socio-economic has to be, you know, across tabbed in terms of who has access, because this large number of OBCs into higher, private higher education, also because of their have landholdings and their better.
Says that you can function as a for-profit, but when we see that the providers are actually a lot of for-profit and how they function, there would be different connotation towards what things they are doing. So that is one thing. And regarding, I would, she asked about particularly Adarsh thing, that how...
I cited it as an example.
So but Adarsh is a PPP scheme that we have to remember. So that government has stated that it is a formalized PPP structure that we are coming up, that they are implementing. So that is definitely a PPP, and of course, as Pam said, that we have to see what sort of partnerships were there and now we are having. So there is a very clear-cut demarcation of what used to exist and what current forms are. And regarding the role of students, learners and teacher unions, these are just asked. So I would say there is not particular literature which have actually looked at how unions are reacting or how students have actually faced. But the thing is, when I went to the field, so there were a lot of teachers who were like on contract, and actually what those teachers were, there was a PUN PPP program which was actually started by the Haryana government with some computer technology firm. And they actually hired bulk of teachers who were like para teachers or contract, and all of a sudden government abandoned that program and teachers were left with no jobs. And so they were actually, and they were very hesitant to talk to me, because since their status of employment was not known, and they were very scared to talk. They said, we can't talk because we are guests. So they were very scared, but they provided the accounts how the unions actually, they formulated a union of such group of teachers who were like these para teachers, and they were commuter teachers. So they were fighting long cases against the government and the company, that what about us? So they depicted some small anecdotal stories, but which are very interesting, but these never come to fore, because these are they don't reflect formally about those stories, but these are the things which they keep on saying. And a lot of things actually get reflected in newspapers. So how unions are reacted, they come in the newspapers, not per se in the studies. So, but it's very interesting how teachers are reacting. So, and their views about how they see how private sector has entered, whether how their works is actually getting diluted or maybe improved, that is their take. But we have
And at the same time, what is getting now recently getting reported or gets to the newspapers is also very tough. I mean, even if there are such contestations, they do not get it over it enough. They do not get it.
To clarify, I mean, not to clarify, to add what Husain said about profit and non-profit. So, profiteering is not allowed, but what is allowed instead is reasonable surplus.
Yeah,
so
that doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
Exactly, and that's what I also found that evidence from my field study, that private technical institutions, they used to inflate the cost component so that they can, you know, suffer the norms. So that is the practice. And regarding the role of students and teachers, so I, there is like the dearth of studies, but I had the opportunity to look at one paper, working paper, where three of my fellow researchers are working. So there they looked at case studies of JNU, I think Pune Film Institute and Mumbai universities. So obviously the role of students' education in resisting some of the, you know, the student unions, in resisting the government policies, these are confined to a kind, you know, a few public institutions. Mm-hmm. Where the relationship of teachers and students are, I mean, the students are not seen, students are seen as a collaborator, mm-hmm. you know, in the process. So that mm-hmm. is important. In case of private institutions, unions are banned in most of the cases, so they can't form unions. Mm-hmm. So the collective, their role in collective decision making is also very limited.
Okay, you get the final word.
No, not 5 minutes, 2 minutes.
2 minutes? Okay, let me add.
We are hungry, we want to go for lunch.
Okay, just 3 minutes. You know, the study mentioned by Mon, the student participation is actually a British Council funded study. Let me begin with the student, therefore, as Eliza's particular question. I'm tempted to share my understanding with her, with you all. You know this, I'm quite puzzled. If the quality is bad of any service, then the provider should exit the market. This is simple logic. Right? The providers cannot continue to sustain their operation if the quality being provided is bad. How come for education they continue to thrive? I think here lies the importance of the intended beneficiaries, that the students. In health, if I'm not cured of my, you know, some problem, ailment, then I can raise my voice. Right? No, not me, not me. Students, they don't even know what is the quality of education. Right?
It's the same in health.
The same in health. No, no, I can feel the pain. The students cannot feel the pain. Students are gradually... Huh? No,
I think you're digging a hole for yourself.
No, no, I'm digging a hole. Students silently endure. And when they realize the quality is bad, it's all over for them. In health, they can feel the pain. The students are very good.
Yeah,
anyway,
they die.
No, no, no. No, no, I have already Taka, this is no, this is interesting. No, student union, I believe in the private educational institution, the student unions are not really allowed. For the government institutions, again, the students union are not really allowed. There's a general tendency to suffocate the voices of the students, and particularly in the last 2-3 years, I will not take the name of any particular institution. My second is about Jasmine's question. Iman has already answered. The cost inflation is actually profit siphoning out. The other is that it's a very interesting question which was raised in the Planning Commission meeting on PPP. When they were approaching for lunch, somebody raised the hand from behind, a participant from private entity, and said, Planning Commission meeting, those were the days, UPA 2 regime. They said, you tell us how are we going to make profit. Don't tell us what sort of partnership. Motive is very clear. We are going to be with you, but tell us how to make profit. Then the representative of the Planning Commission said, look at clause number so and so, you can make profit. How? By collaborating with a third party. Right? So you can't make profit, but the third party can make profit. That is how, when I visited a private university in Delhi, the third parties are very much in operation, right? They are providing services and they share the profit with, like, you know, the photocopying would be exorbitant, laundry, the books, exorbitantly priced, and the students, they don't have anything to go by, and therefore the profit is, you know, the siphon. Regarding the foreign education, Anupam has already said, a couple of interesting things. One was that Delhi University experimented with a 4-year undergraduate program to allow international mobility of the students and the foreign providers. Right? So that was the underlying thing. Might be somebody who had critical of neoliberal and leftist, I would be arguing like this, but there are many people who would argue that that was indeed the case. Second is that the foreign education provider bill could not be passed in the UPATU regime because of the very steep resistance from the left. Third is that in the recent emerging scenario, the foreign faculty can come and teach, private university can collaborate very, that for research is absolutely fine, but since the foreign universities could not be ushered into the Indian domain, there are various other ways of this collaboration where this privatization of, along with them would actually take place. Collaboration fund. That's all. Last question. Yeah. Please.
Okay. See, the thing. So, in
in the process of writing or formulating of the policy is the role of the private actors. For example, there are some actors who have gained legitimacy in terms of, you know, by providing data that this is not working and that is not working, and then they become collaborators in the writing of the policy, and which has implications for, you know, how the policy becomes less public and more, you know, in favor of the privatization of the private.
For example, price for more coupons, as entire floor in planning commission, sitting 40 employees
and many other populations working with the Delhi government, though it might look, you know, very open to many options, but the simply bringing in these private actors into writing the public policy documents is a big hurdle.
I remember just one sentence. I think, you know, Imon and you can say better. When the foreign universities were being invited to come and set up institution in India, that time I think the debate arose about reasonable surplus and the profit. But the court ruled that the foreign universities would be allowed to make surplus. They cannot take the surplus back to their countries, but the surplus has to be reinvested. Because without being lured by the surplus or profit, whatever, why should they be setting up the institution in a country?
Okay, on that basis, we shall close and go for lunch. Give them a big hand.